Morning friends, today we are going to learn the brachial plexus in a very unique manner. It is with the help of 3D diagram. So in this particular we are going to talk about the both the things, that is little bit of theory and then demonstration also. So first of all, what is brachial plexus? So again we are going to dissect the word brachial and plexus. So brachial means relating to the upper limb and plexus means a network. So here we are going to talk about the network of nerves which is going to supply the upper limb. Okay, so this particular topic we are going to divide it into four parts, or we can say brachial plexus is divided into four parts: roots, trunks, division, cords, and then further branches. So basically whatever right now we are seeing, this we are seeing the upper part only. Branches we will deal with some other lecture. So what is root? So root, as we simply understand, root will be the basic unit from where the things will come out. So we all know the nerves or the spinal nerves come from the foramen, from the vertebrae. And here we are going to quickly talk about the spinal nerves C5, C6, C7, C8 and T1. These are the five nerve roots of the brachial plexus. You can see it here. This is anterior ramus of C5, C6, C7. C8 and this is of T1. So always remember, here there are both anterior and posterior ramus, and add here in brachial plexus we are only going to take the anterior ramus of the C5 to T1. Sometimes C4 is included, then T1 is left out. Sometimes T2 is included, then C4 are left out. So this particular phenomenon is known as prefixed or postfixed. If C4 is included, then it is prefixed. And if the T2 is included, then it will be the postfix. So these are certain two variations. Then after formation of the roots, or we can see, we have seen the roots. You can see roots. Yeah, like this. Okay, like this. You can see it. These are the foramens from where these roots are coming out. Okay. Now the picture is very clear. No? After this, they are going to join together and form the trunks. Okay, R then T. So C5 and C6 is going to form the upper trunk. You can see here C5, C6, they are going to form the upper trunk. Then the middle trunk will be directly the continuation of C7 directly. So this is C7, and it is directly going to form the medial trunk. And then the last two, C8 and T1, they are going to form the inferior trunk. The roots, which were 5 in number, now are going to convert it or converge into the 3 trunks. This mixing actually helps in the proper management or proper control of the further muscles of the upper limb with 2 or 3 root value having things. So they will be more better control or controlling of the muscles will be there. Then after this, there will be divisions. After trunk, there will be divisions. So you can see here, this is anterior and posterior divisions. So each of the trunk is going to have anterior and posterior division. So like the upper trunk will have 2, anterior posterior, then again 2, then again 2. So everyone will have 2 the divisions. Next comes the cords, last part. After that there will be branches. The cords, there are 3 cords basically: lateral cord, you can see here lateral cord, then the medial cord, and then the posterior cord. Posterior cord, as you can see, it is going a little bit posterior side. Okay, like this you can understand. From here the roots were there, and then the cords. The posterior one is going back side. This will go lateral side, and this here it is the medial side. Okay, so how they are going to form? The lateral cord is specifically formed by the union of anterior divisions of upper and medial trunks. Medial cord is formed by the continuation of anterior division of lower trunk, and all the dorsal divisions of all the trunks, that is anterior, medial and posterior, they are going to get union of and going to form the posterior cord. So this is posterior cord, this is lateral cord, and this is medial cord. So this you can see is the total. The back side also you can see So the here you have to remove these muscles. Actually, these are sclerenius muscle, which if we remove, then it will be more clear. So the best view which we can see in this particular diagram is this only. Okay. Now further, what will happen? So these are the basic four divisions of the plantar plexus: root, trunk, division, and pods. Now one by one, we have to study the branches also. So for learning the branches, we can see some other diagram also is there, I think. Like this. This is also the same thing, a little bit collateral branches they are saying. The red one, you can see this is the, here it is the subclavian artery, then it will continue as the axillary artery. Okay, and then further it will continue as the brachial artery. Here you can see lateral cord is this. This will be the further division, we will talk about it. So there are branches from every, nearly every part actually. So first of all, we will see the branches of the root. From the roots, there are two branches. One branch is the nerve to serratus anterior. Nerve to serratus anterior. And second branch is the nerve to rhomboides. Nerve to serratus anterior is also known as long thoracic nerve. You can see here. This is long thoracic nerve. And it is directly coming from the roots. That is C5, C6 and C7. You can see here, these are spongeboard. These are small rootlets which are converging into a nerve, and that nerve is known as long thoracic nerve, which gives supplies to the serratus anterior. Then second one is nerve to rhomboides, also known as dorsal scapular nerve. So rhomboides is muscle which is present on the back side, and you can see a twig is going towards the back side also. This is only the continuation of only one root, that is C5. You can see this is continuation from here, C5. Okay. And these three were the continuation which will go to the serratus anterior. So these two are only the branches of the roots. So nerve to serratus anterior and nerve to rhomboides. Next one, the branches from the trunks. Again, you get it two, but only upper trunk gives the branches. Okay. So one is subscapular nerve. You can see here, this is subscapular nerve. And the next one is nerve to subclavius. And next one is nerve to subclavius or subclavian nerve. Okay, so as the name suggests, they are going to give supply to that particular muscle only. As they are from the upper trunk, these are from the C5 and C6 root. Well, next comes the bigger part, that is the branches of cords. So we are going to see cord wise, the lateral cord, we are going to get three: lateral pectoral, muscular cutaneous, and lateral root of median nerve. Then we are going to get five from the medial cord: medial pectoral, medial cutaneous of arm, medial cutaneous of forearm, then a specific one, ulnar, and then median root of median nerve. From the posterior cord, we are again going to get five: upper subscapular, nerve to latissimus dorsi, lower subscapular, axillary nerve, and radial nerve. Okay, so I think you can see further in next part only. Here, then twigs are given. So one by one we can see, we are not going to talk in too much detail, it will take too much time. So here you can see this is axillary nerve, which is the part from the posterior cord, okay, which will be further divided. The axillary nerve gives supplies to mainly to the deltoid, okay, and some muscles of the scapula. So as you can see, this is from the back side we are seeing. These are the roots, these are the branches which are going. Okay. Next, we can see the radial nerve. Radial nerve is also the branch of posterior cord. It is one of the long nerve. Okay. So posterior cutaneous nerve, this is radial nerve, which will be continuous. Posterior cutaneous nerve, and then posterior branch or deep branch of lateral nerve. Okay. So when it comes to the arm, it is given to the known as posterior interosseous nerve of forearm. That's why posterior interosseous nerve of forearm is the branch of, or the continuation of the radial nerve itself. Then we can see the cutaneous nerve. Muscular cutaneous nerve is the branch of lateral cord. It is an important branch of lateral cord, and this particular branch can be easily identified because it pierces the muscle known as coracobrachial. You can see here, it is piercing the muscle, and this muscle is coracobrachialis, and the nerve is muscular cutaneous nerve. This whole thing is muscular cutaneous nerve, and it will give supply to the all the muscles which are present in arm region, whether it is biceps, coracobrachialis, or brachialis. All will be supplied by this particular nerve only. That is muscular cutaneous nerve. Then there is median nerve. Median nerve is a unique nerve. As we have seen, it has one of the twig, that is lateral root of the median nerve, is coming from the lateral cord, and then the medial root of median nerve is coming from the medial cord. So when we see it, here they are actually showing from the forearm region only. We will see again one diagram which will be showing it from the upper arm or arm region. You can see this is median nerve. Then again median nerve. This is very clinically important because carpal tunnel syndrome is going to happen in this particular flexor retrocnemius area, and the nerve which is going to be damaged is the median nerve only. Then these are the further branches of the distal branches of the median nerve. So this is median nerve. Now the ulnar nerve, because they are not giving any branches in the arm region, that's why in this particular software they are not shown from the continuation from the arm. They are shown from the area from where they are going to be supply only. So here you can see on the ulnar side, that is little finger side, a nerve is there in continuation with this ulnar nerve, which supplies in this particular area of hypothenar region. Okay, this is ulnar nerve. Then you can see, this is one of the very important diagrams that shows whole branching of cutaneous nerve. So you can see here, this is subscapular nerve, then this is axillary nerve, pectoral nerve, median cutaneous nerve, infralateral cutaneous nerve, infropostopachial nerve, medial cutaneous nerve of forearm, lateral cutaneous nerve of forearm. This is superficial branch of ulnar nerve, median nerve, and superficial branch of radial nerve. So these are the cutaneous nerve supply of the anterior surface or flexor surface. Here you can see the extensor surface. Again, it is supraclavicular, then axillary nerve, infropostobrachial, then medial cutaneous nerve of arm, posterior cutaneous nerve of arm, posterior cutaneous nerve of forearm, median cutaneous nerve of forearm, lateral cutaneous nerve of forearm, superficial branch of radial nerve, and superficial branch of ulnar nerve. So this whole thing, whatever we have done till now, these were the cutaneous supplies. Again, we will come back to this diagram. So this diagram is very crucial for understanding the brachial plexus. Okay, so brachial plexus, as we have seen, the branches, what we have learned, the branches of the cord, branches of the root, branches of the trunk, and then a very important thing is little bit clinical anatomy. So two basic things you have to remember here: Erb's paralysis and Lemke's paralysis. Erb paralysis is due to the injury in the upper trunk of brachial plexus. So this here particularly what happens, six particular nerves are going to get joined, and the injury may occur due to birth, that is during the perforation, during the fall of shoulder, and then sometime due to the anesthesia also this can be happened. And then the nerve roots which are basically involved are C5 and C6. I have already told this is from the upper trunk region. What are the symptoms? Actually, we have to learn here that symptoms will form the typical posture known as policeman tip hand or porter's hand. The disability will be abduction and related rotation of arm, flexion and supination of forearm, biceps and supinated jerk will be the loss, and cessation of loss over the small area over the lower part of delta. So all this will be constitute the Erb's paralysis. There is one more known as Lemke's paralysis. Lemke's paralysis is especially on the lower trunk. So the root involved for basically T1 and sometimes C8 also. certain muscles are going to be paralyzed here, like intrinsic muscles of the hand, ulnar flexor of the wrist. Deformity which is going to form will be known as claw head, something like this, claw head. Okay, and then also there will be some more symptoms like Horner syndrome may be there. So basically whatever symptoms are related with plantar plexuses can be summarized in paralysis and plantar paralysis. So this is all for this particular lecture.